morning, my dear students. You remember last class, we just introduced the author and read the first two lines that bring out the feelings of the mother holding baby at her bosom, that heavenliness on this earth, the tenderest feeling human heart ever can have. The unimaginable dreams, the visions of the mother, what we have to imagine. And to such a mother who is so anxious to know about the future of her child, the prophet, supposed to be the man of God, speaking on behalf of God, the future of the man, very curtly, very cruelly speaks, "Your child is not your child." His lips are just like the sharp blades of a scissor. The two blades, two lips, cut things sharp. Now, to the wondering mother, mother who couldn't understand the prophet understand mother's predicament, and the prophet tries, begins to explain what he wanted the mother to know. What he says, "They are the sons and daughters of life longing for itself." What he told, "Your children, not your children." Then who are the children? "They are the sons and daughters of life longing for itself." You are the test. See the first line. Poet has written the word life with capital letter. You know why in the middle of the line the poet has used the capital letter L, because it is personification of life. Life is personified. So what the prophet says, life wants to express itself, longing for, longing means that desire of life to produce itself, found expression through you, not by you, through you. So you are just instruments in the hand of life. Later, by the end of the poem, we will find different meanings for the word life. You will die and go. Generations will come to this earth, go from this earth, but life will go on this earth. This is what the famous Alfred Lord Tennyson, in the poem The Brook, has written: "Men may come, men may go, but I go on forever." I miss the brook. Here, parents will come, parents will go, but life goes on forever. Unending process of life, giving life to life. So I'll give you a very small example that you will easily understand. All of you have got pen and book with you. You open the book, I'll ask you to write something. Take your pen, you write. You just write the name of the poem, On Children, written by Khalil Gibran. When I check your book, the handwriting is so beautiful. It is looks still better than the printed handwriting. So, how beautiful is the handwriting? And the pen can never claim credit for the handwriting. Can the pen say, "See, I have written so well. See how I write"? If the pen claims the credit for good handwriting, all people who know the role of the pen in handwriting will make fun of the pen. It is the child who holds the pen responsible for the quality of the writing. So what the prophet says, you are just an instrument in the hand of life. You don't have life to give. You don't have life. How can you give what you don't have? Even your life is given by life. Life asks you to reproduce. So life is giving life. Life is using parents as a medium, just as the child is using pen as a medium to write. So longing for, life wants to express itself. Yes, and they say, he wants to express, expression, wants to express. They come through you but not from you. Now the prophet slowly becoming intelligible, understandable. Life comes through you. Children come through you. Through means just a medium, not from you. You are not the author of life. Just as child writes something in the book through the pen, but pen doesn't write. You keep the pen, ask the pen to write, it won't write. So life only gives life. Life has chosen you as a medium to bring forth life, not to create life. You have no power. How could you give something that you don't have? So they come through you, but not from you. Now the prophet is beginning to explain the relationship between parents and children. First he says, not your child. Second he says, children are the children of life. You are just a medium. But the prophet is now explaining what should be the ideal relationship between parents and children. So we know many types of parents in the world. In our motherland, when we had the practice of, even now it is there still, the joint families, children always took care of the parents, and again taking care of the elderly parents was a virtue according to our culture and civilization, a duty given us by God to take care of the elderly parents, still more elderly grandparents, equal to serving God. That was our concept. So in such a circumstance, normally parents would expect children to be of some support for them in their old age. That is a culture. Now we have been hearing all around cries that children abandon the elderly parents. They don't take care of the elderly parents. Many are left in the asylum, and many are left in the street. Many children fondly brought up by parents are very well settled in America. Elderly parents back at home in India, what connection they have between is just a telephone call. Neglected parents. Western countries practice started earlier. We are always aping the West. Now, though they are with you, because you gave birth to the child, telling the mother, mother is hearing it. We take this poem as an independent unit. We don't go to the background of the poem. This much background is enough. There are people who say this poem is not to be considered a great poem. Many people speak differently of Gibran, and some criticize him for the nudity in what he write. But we don't mind all those things. We take this poem as a piece of art. We don't mind Gibran. We have left when we started the poem, we left Gibran. When we start this poem, we don't remember Elizabeth Haskell or Josephine Preston. We forget them. We just concentrate on the lines here, because this is the piece of art. How do we appreciate, analyze, enjoy, and if possible, learn some lessons from this piece of art? Though they are with you, because you are going to birth a child, baby would be spending maximum time with the mother, side of the mother. They belong not to you. Belong means property. They are not your property. For us, very difficult to accept it. My son, not your son, life's son of the girl. We find it very difficult to accept. What he says, they belong not to you. They stay with you, but not your property. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts. Maximum you can give, you must give to the child you have to love the child. The child should never grow up love starved. Lavish love on the child. Lavish love on the child by the parents. We find the difference between children who are brought up by their parents and who are growing up in the world without their parents. Tremendous difference. We find that the children growing up in orphanages who have no parents, how they grow up love starved. The rice would be always hungry for love. Whereas you children, lucky children, brought up by parents, lavishing affection on you, satisfying all your need, you never starve for love. You are the treasures of your parents. They lavish their love. Whatever you need, they give. Prophet says, love. When we love, we give. When Elizabeth Haskell loved Gibran, she gave so much to him. Phoebe also gave so much to him. When you love, you give. You love the child. Love the child. But love, but don't give your ideas. Your ideas so dangerous for the child. If you stuff the mind of your child with your ideas, he will remain here with you. He will never be able to go forward. Life has to go forward. So love the child. Don't stuff the child with your ideas. That means in modern language, never, never brainwash your child. Lavish love. We stop it here. We continue the next session. Thank you.